Good evening, everybody. Welcome to today's talk. Before we proceed with the talk, I'll just take a minute to introduce today's topic as well as today's speaker. As you know, today's title is Will the Stimulus Package Revive Indian Economy? So it is common knowledge, or it is in everybody's view right now, that Indian government has announced a 20 lakh crore rupees stimulus package, with the intention of reviving the Indian economy, which is suffering under the reel of COVID-19 and all such issues. But what exactly is the stimulus package? Does it have the capacity to revive the Indian economy? What effects will it have? Or is it just another jumla or a sham by the government, which has been the case in the past? So to throw some light on this, to give a valued opinion, we have today with us Prabir Purkayasa, is president of FSMI and editor in chief of NewsClick, to take us through this. So with that, I welcome Prabir. And so today's moderator would be Srujana. With that, I think we can go ahead and start the session. Over to you, Srujana.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the session. This session will be around 45 minutes, and after that will be followed by question answers. And you can post your questions in the comments, and they'll be passed on to the speaker. And also, please note that the comments are moderated, so it might take a while for your comments to reflect on the page. With that, we can begin the session. Over to you, Prabir.
Okay. Of course, the fundamental question remains, why do you ask the president of the free software movement, who's supposed to know technology, of course, I only said supposed, to talk about economic stimulus, because this should have been done by, more appropriately rather, by an economist. But the FSMI leadership, including Kiran and Praveen, felt that the economists are not able to communicate to tech people. And therefore, they decided I could be a kind of translator who try and read what they have written and tell you what, or tell people who don't understand economics or the language of the economists, what does an economic stimulus mean? What does this 20 lakh crore mean? And so on. So I will start with what is an economic stimulus, because we can only talk about whether this is really a stimulus or not once we know what it really means, because otherwise it's another English word to us. That's it. So let us start with what is an economic stimulus and why are economic stimuli, plural, Latin, why are they necessary, okay? Or when are they necessary? So the economic stimulus is given when the economy is either in a crisis in terms of shrinking, that the growth is not happening or not happening enough, or actually negative growth is happening. In that case, we need to revive the economy, meaning we need to start economic activity again so that the growth becomes positive or growth increases. Roughly, India has been having post-independence something like 5, 6, 8% growth, depending on the years. Post-1990s, we've been claiming we have been having growth 7 to 8%. And Modi has been talking about also that we will go to 10, 12, 13, 14% growth. As you know, the future is always extremely bright, unlike the past. So that has been the kind of claims made. But India has been having a steady growth for quite some time. And this, of course, the economic growth terms, what we mean is, of course, the growth of the GDP. GDP, as you know, is a gross domestic product. It's a sum of all the things we produce or all the incomes we earn put together. So that is not, in some sense, an indicator of what I will call the real economy. The real economy is what you produce physically and what you consume physically. That's at the end of it, what the real economy is. And of course, the GDP reflects in some sense the real economy, because at the end of it, if you're not either producing or consuming, then the economic growth cannot be there. The economy cannot show anything positive. So you are, of course, going to have to accept that there is a drop of your economic activity and therefore of the GDP as well. Because of the COVID-19 lockdowns, particularly the lockdowns, it's of course true that the lockdowns were necessary in order to break the links of the transmission of the disease itself. And if we had not had the lockdown, we would have probably had a much higher rate of infections. Of course, this is also true that that only gave us a breathing space within which we had to do contact tracing, testing, and actually strengthen our hospital system to be able to take the number of infections coming in. So it was, in that sense, buying time for what was to come. It was not an end in itself, because otherwise a lockdown only postpones infection. It doesn't really stop infections from happening. It just says it will not happen now, it will happen sometime in the future. So therefore, a lockdown is not an action by which you reduce infections. You only postpone infections, or at most what you do is reduce the rapid increase which otherwise might take place. So as you know, we have had lockdown 1, 2, 3, and we are talking of 4 and 5 at the moment. So a number of lockdowns of different intensities are taking place. Consequences, of course, are visible. That economic activity of a large number of people, large sectors, have actually reduced. And people are not able to go to work, people are not getting work, the factories are not running, the small establishments have closed down. You have a lot of what is called the informal sector. And as you know, Indian economy runs really based on the informal sector. A lot of the informal sector is at the moment not functioning. So the stimulus, if we are talking about, has to account for the fact that the Indian economy at the moment is in a crisis. A lot of both employment and production has gone. The number of people who have lost jobs are very high. Probably they would account for at least 50 to 60% of the people who are employed today. Employed, again, not necessarily the formal sector, but from household to all other activities, economic activities, I'm counting as a part of this economic activity. So if all those people lose their jobs, you would have a situation which reflects the fact that economic activity has decreased sharply. If the economic activity decreases sharply, what you're likely to see is a drop in the GDP this year. That means instead of increasing every year, as we have been doing, the next 12 months, starting from the financial year of April to the next March, which is India's financial year, you are likely to see a drop of economic activity and probably a drop of GDP itself, which means you will have what is called negative growth. Now, what happens when you have negative growth? That means your economic activities on the ground are not taking place. So how do you make that happen? This is not a crisis of India alone. Different countries have been facing this problem. And all of these countries have therefore doing one thing. They're pumping money into the economy. When we talk about pumping money into the economy, and that's what we really will come to, that is money which goes directly to the hands of the people who would therefore be able to consume. And if they're able to consume goods, then there would also be the market for goods, and therefore economic activity in terms of production would take place. Production does not take place by itself. Production requires a market where people are there to buy goods. And if people are not there to buy goods, then there is hardly any likelihood of people then producing, companies producing or groups producing, small informal sector also producing, because they know that there are no buyers. So the key issue that comes up when you have a crisis of this kind is that you need to create demand. Demand means people's ability to buy. It is people, small companies, big companies, their ability to buy. But at the end of it, companies buy from other companies. That is not going by itself to produce a demand. At the end of it, people at the end of the chain, that means who are physically consuming goods, either basically buying stuff for their house, for their other activities, or people buying equipment for manufacturing purposes, or people buying for direct consumption, food and other things, for instance. If we don't have that kind of demand, you are unlikely at the end of it to see people actually being able to produce. And if you do not produce, obviously, you are not going to see an increase of GDP. Because at the end of it, don't forget, GDP adds up all the productions and that becomes your gross domestic product. So this is the basic issue, that a gross domestic product can only take place if there are products to sell. And products to sell will only exist if there are buyers in the market. So at the moment, what you have is what is called a complete collapse of the buyer in the market. So this is the crisis of the Indian economy at this stage. And as I was talking about, most countries are facing a similar position, and they have done one thing as stimulus, which is they have pumped money, basically money into the system. Pumping money into the system in various ways. Of course, if you have a company, if you have a country like the United States, where you have a very similar kind of government in place, meaning right-wing, believes in essentially sectarian politics. And their pro-rich policies means that out of this huge stimulus which the US is supposed to be giving, also about 85 to 90% are going to the rich, and it will not translate into a physical stimulus. But even here, even the Trump government has put money in the hands of the workers who have lost their jobs, who have been sacked, whatever reason, that there is money even here which has been given, what are called salary checks being given with Trump's signature on them. All that is also being done. If we take the 20 lakh crore Indian stimulus, there are two kinds of problem with this so-called stimulus. I'm saying it is a so-called stimulus because a number of economists have said this is really not a stimulus. If we take the first is, what is the dimension of the stimulus? Then the government is claiming it's 10%. Now, 10% stimulus, does it mean there is actually physically 10% money being offered by the government to the people? Is it a physical expansion in terms of what money people will have? If it were so, then yes, we would call it a stimulus. As Prabhat Patnaik in the NewsClick interview said, that if there is money that does not enter the market, it cannot be called a stimulus. So offering credit, that means if, for instance, the government says, well, we'll let people take more loans. So RBI increases the limit on borrowings. It essentially puts, parks more money in the accounts of the banks, for instance, that you can take, increase your credit. Now, that increase in credit by itself does not constitute a stimulus, because if it does not enter the market in terms of buying goods, then that does not constitute any extra economic stimulus. The economy will not feel it. It's just an accounting trick. What does it really mean? That supposing I say, hey, you can borrow from me. You said, okay, very good. Put it into my bank account. I put the money in your bank account. Then you don't spend it, okay? You let it sit on your account. Maybe you buy some shares with it, okay? Maybe you put it in the bank in a fixed deposit. Maybe you just use it to pay off other loans you had with another bank. None of these translates at the end of the day to an economic stimulus, because it just has entered my accounts, your accounts, but it has not entered the physical economy where goods, as I said, are produced or consumed. So given this, the extension of the credit which the government or the Reserve Bank of India is talking about constitutes almost half the so-called 20 lakh crore stimulus. So if I take away the credit expansion, which is what the government has talked about in different ways, then we are really talking about a 10 lakh crore amount. Now, second part of the problem that is there, a lot of this 10 lakh crore, what is being called as a stimulus, are again parts of different kinds of again, credit guarantees given to fishermen, given to small industries. A very large part of this, the 3 lakh crore talk, is about the what I call the small, medium scale sectors. Now, these, of course, they have been redefined to be even up to 100 crore, but I'm not going to go with that. So they are supposed to be something like 8.5 lakh crore, small business, small and medium business. Now, these companies, out of them, only about 40 to 50 lakh of them have the ability to have credit from the banks. They cannot otherwise access bank credit. Now, this 3 lakh crore, which has been talked about as basically a mechanism to fund the small-scale sector, no money is being given to them. What is being said is government will backstop. That means government guarantees the loans they take. And if they default, then government will actually pay the banks who are giving the loans. But it does not mean the banks therefore give the loans, nor does it mean that these companies will take loans. So, as I said, out of the 8.5 crore of this small and medium scale sector, and mind you, this is in the 10 lakh crore, which is not what the RBI credit limits expansions were, which were really to big business. This is about small scale sector, and this is really the big ticket item in the Pradhan Mantri Atmanirbhar Yojana and so on. So if you take that, the 3 lakh crore we are talking about is also something which is, again, credits being guaranteed by the government, but not physically made available to the small and medium scale industry. Now, they in turn had asked for something else. They had said, give us cash because we have to pay our workers, and we cannot pay workers because we have no money. So they said, give us 1 lakh crore, at least 50% of the workers' salaries that we can pay. So that the government has not done. And the government has also not relaxed the other ways to giving money to them. They want cash. They don't want credit. So they said, give us money so that we can restart our business. Instead of that, government has really offered credit again. So if we offer credit and they're not able to take it, it again will not translate into a economic stimulus. The big problem is this 8.5 lakh crore small and medium scale sector in India. This is the crux of the India's employment. This is where 80% of, if not 85% of India's workforce is. They're not in the big industries. They're not in basically other big establishments. Most of India's employment comes really from this section of the economy. So if this section, and it's 8.5 lakh crore establishments we are talking about, if they are not able to avail of the credit, that means you're going to have a paper guarantee, but very little will translate in terms of it reaching the people. And even when it does, it probably will get eaten up by their other loans that they have already taken. It will not lead to an economic activity picking up in any significant way. So there goes another 3 lakh crore from the other 10 lakh crore we had talked about. 7.5 lakh crore was essentially the Reserve Bank, the various other things which are there. Then we come to other stimuli which have been talked about, and there are the whole number of them. Some of them are MNREGA arrears, promise of increasing the MNREGA employment. Again, not transfers of money, but we will give you employment. As you know, the MNREGA employment in the last 2 months and the lockdown has dropped dramatically. And it doesn't also provide the urban people with any employment. It's basically for non-urban poor. So urban poor, who are also being hit, particularly in the lockdown period, because at least at the agrarian level, there is some economic activity going on in terms of the food grains being gathered and so on, but not in the urban areas. They're not covered by MNREGA. So there is also no support provided to them as of now. And that is also visible in the huge outflow of migrants that we have seen. I think Sainath, if you remember, talked about it again in NewsClick, where he had talked about the last 10 years, the government of India accepts the urban areas have sort of seen a huge influx of rural population coming for work. This is what we call the migrant population. They're not migrants in the sense they don't come for some period and go back every year. They are people who have come here and who have employment in the cities or the towns. So this is the population, and they number probably somewhere near 10 to 12 crores. So there is no sustenance provided for them. So again, they have no income. And again, if they have no income, there is no stimulus again. So if you talk about this, that there is, in fact, the other part of the problem, that all other schemes we are talking about, whether it's about fishermen, whether it is about other schemes they have talked about, disaster management, all of these were already existing schemes. And what other people have commented, these are really recycled schemes, that they are schemes which already existed, they had already been announced. As I said, one of them was the fisherman support scheme. Disaster management was supposed to be given every year. Some money has already been allotted for that. They were a part of our budget, or they are already announced before the COVID struck. So all of these are recycled schemes. So if there is, again, a list of them available in different papers, different articles in different places. But if we take all of this away, we still then would find what is left, which is the actual physical stimulus. Now, various people have made calculations of what the actual additional money that will be put into the market in the hands of the people in order to for the economy to pick up. And if we add all of that up, it appears that out of the 20 lakh crore, the actual stimulus would be in the range of 0.8 to 1.2%. If we are optimistic, we'll put it at 1%. So out of the total amount of 20 lakh crore, at best, 2 lakh crore is the actual physical stimulus that has been provided, which is the money which will come to the Indian economy, and which will be actually be in the hands of the people, who then will spend it, and hopefully it will be extra economic activity. Now, if you're talking of a 4 to 5 point shrinkage of the GDP, and this is not figures that I'm giving, but these are figures which are being now calculated across the globe, and there are figures which would seem to indicate that the drop could be even more. But even if we take a drop of only 5% of India's economic activity, then 1% stimulus is certainly not going to help to counteract it any big way. The second problem with the stimulus is, since most of it goes in terms of credit guarantees, so what we are really doing is we're not putting money in the hands of the people who need it the most, which is the people who at the moment do not have any income whatsoever and do not have any income for last 2 to 3 months. This is a section which you see on the roads going back to the villages without the government even making any preparations before the lockdown, during the lockdown, and even at this stage where they have absolutely nothing to live upon in the urban areas. And instead of providing them food, the government has been continuously talking, okay, we'll give them ration shop, we'll give them some quota of food, which is an actual stimulus. I'm not going to deny giving food from the ration shops in terms of grains is certainly a stimulus. So that those things are the only things government has done, but that's not enough, because people need money. It's not just food, grains by itself will not work. You still need to cook them. You need to give people other things also. There are other things like, for instance, paying your landlord. You need to provide milk for your little children. So all of those things are not being taken care of, forcing these people to actually leave for their homes. This is the reason why people have cycled 1,000 kilometers carrying their ill father behind them. People have hopped into buses, trucks, tempos, whatever they could find, or walked. And we have this, heartrending sights that we have seen. So this section would have had a double purpose. You'd have kept them in the cities, helped therefore to reduce the infection that we are now going to spread all over the country. Also the kind of way they have traveled in packed trucks, the buses and trains, and also you would have done the humane task of, at this point, providing of the support they needed, and of course helping the economy as well. So why wasn't this done? That's a key question I'd like to place before you, that why is it that at this point of time, the stimulus has been mainly credit being given to the banks, to big business. Of course, the offer is there for small business as well. As we have discussed, most of the small businesses do not have the ability to take loans. They already probably indebted to banks. And by what their organizations say, only 40 to 50 lakh crore out of the 8 crore establishment even have the ability to approach a bank or have bank accounts and so on. So given this state of affairs, why did the government not decide to do what would be both would have provided a real stimulus to the economy, and it have also added essentially welfare to the people, that it have provided them some relief, some at least sustenance for people who had they and their families left for starvation? So why did not they do this? Because it seems obvious that that is both economically rational as well as humanely. This is something that should have been done. And here the answer that we get is a very strange one. And this is something that the finance minister has talked about, and the various other people in the government have also been saying, that they believe that if they provide a physical stimulus, which means money being pumped directly into the economy, then that would increase the deficit. Now, what is a deficit? The deficit is that you have to, what is called, print money. If you have an economy where the government expenditure is X, okay, and the government's expenditure is met by borrowings, as well as what income it earns, which is through taxes. Now, if there is a difference between what it gets from taxes and what it has to spend, this difference is made up by actually the government borrowing, technically, from the Reserve Bank, which means printing cash. So you print extra cash, and that cash then comes to the government's account and you spend that money. Now, this is what is called the deficit. The deficit is what you actually spend over and above what you actually get as taxes. Now, if the deficit increases, if your economy is growing, it will not be a problem because your future earnings will make up for the deficit you now have. So the argument is that a growing economy can afford to have a larger deficit. When you don't have a growing economy, then you have to worry about creating a deficit and getting into some kind of a debt trap, which is what is talked about by economists. I'm not going to get into these details. For that, you really have to get an economist, not an engineer claiming to know the economy like me. So if we take that into account, what we have to do is that you need to, at this particular crisis moment, you need to borrow, increase your deficit. It's also referred to as helicopter money, which means if I print money at the moment, ask RBI to print money, and that money I use, that's also called today's terms helicopter money. We never heard of this. We just called it deficit and print money. Okay, but now it's also called helicopter money because a lot of the financial sector people don't like it. I'm not going to go into details why they don't, but global finance is strongly against deficit because if they feel there is deficit, then the interest rates will not be so high. If the interest rates are low, then finance does not have so much of interest in these places. So therefore, most countries who at the moment are scared of global finance, listen to global finance and will not increase the deficit. In India, this debate has been going on that should we respect the deficit so much or should we be willing to print money, increase the deficit, but create productive assets, not just meeting your deficit just for, say, salaries, because that's not productive assets. But if you want to increase productive assets, that means future production will pay for the deficit you have created, then you're okay. So not for what is called the revenue account, which means what you have to spend in order for your expenditure over people, other expenditure you might have, even returning cash. So all those are not the reason why you should increase your deficit, but to increase productive assets you create, you actually can increase deficit. And what all bourgeois economists have agreed, that under conditions of crisis, when you have a crash of this kind, where the economy at the moment is languishing because of a lack of demand, this is the appropriate time also to create a increase your deficit, print cash, put purchasing power in the hands of the people, create demand, and that will help the economy to grow. So this is the classical, shall we say, Keynesian theory. And this is where Keynes came close to left on these issues, that yes, the mercantile view of the economy, the merchant's view of economy, which is an accountant's band of vision of the economy. Accountant looks at what is called the khata, the accounts, which is what you write down in books. Books have to balance. They don't understand that an economy is also a dynamic beast. And since it's either growing, staying put, or shrinking, all of these conditions could be possible. That means it is not a static entity. Therefore, just looking at the books is not enough. You have to look at the past and the future, not just look at the current balance that is there. So this is the difference between accountant's view of the economy and a economist's view of the economy, that you just don't look at your books, but you also look at production, you look at what people earn, how people consume. So you take the whole cycle of the economy into account, and out of that, what you see as books are only frozen in one instant of time, what is coming in and what is going out. And that does not give you a picture. The static picture does not give you an understanding of the dynamics of the economy. And if you don't understand the dynamics of the economy, you will still not be able to do, you will not be able to do justice to the economy itself. Particularly when there is a crisis, there is a falling demand, and there's a crisis of this nature just at the moment. At that point of time, all economists would say, spend your way out of the crisis, which means you need to put money in the hands of the people. So both in terms of hard economic thinking, as well as pure humanitarian instincts, the government should have put more money in the hands of the people and in the economy, both of which it hasn't done, because it's really scared of global finance. And if global finance does not like India, then the stock markets don't like this. Money can flow out of the stock markets, and a lot of the global, financial people, and this includes the finance ministers of various countries, they tend to look at the stock market, not at the real economy. Now, what is a stock market and what's its relationship to the real economy? For those who are in software business will know that the huge software companies, and I'm talking about Google, Facebook, Amazon, also in this, not just Microsoft, all of them do not really have direct production. They're all involved either in selling ads, selling us, that is, or in selling software which others have created. All of this is what is called intellectual property. Now, I'm not going to go into a lecture about intellectual property today, but sum total is it does not really add to the physical economy, except that it helps others to grow out of it. But they are the biggest of the stock market today. So their weight in production is low, but their weight in stock market is very high. So if you take those kind of companies into account, of course, the stock market is very, very important. You do what is called sell your share in the stock market. You can realize billions of dollars. as you can see what Reliance has done. They have just sold some stocks to Facebook. Facebook has paid a huge amount of money to Reliance for that. These are all in the expectation that the stock market values Facebook, values Reliance, and therefore they have this much of value, not what they really produce. So the stock market is for the accountants, the benchmark of the economy, not for you and me. And this is the other issue that comes up, that when a Trump looks at the economy, he looks at the stock market. And for the last 10, 20 years, our financial ministers, finance ministers, have been looking at the stock market to talk about the health of the economy, not the health of our budgets. And that is why you will find money has been put in a way that it pushes up the stock market, and all the saving instruments which was there for us, even right now the RBI bonds have stopped being sold, all the old instruments of savings which people have no longer exist, pushing all our savings into mutual funds and into the stock market. So what you have is reorienting the entire economic structure towards the stock market, looking at deficits, not looking at the finance or the economic well-being of the people, but looking at really the well-being of the stock market, because that's where finance capital really plays. And the finance capital main interest is a healthy stock market by which they can play and take the money back. So that also gives them what they call liquidity. They can come in, sell and go. So this short-term way of looking at the economy has trumped, and I'm not referring to Donald Trump, has trumped the way we should really look at the economy, which is take a longer term view. But in this particular case, the long term and the short term for us coincide. Almost everybody agrees, who's a serious economist agrees, that we really need to have a stimulus which is real. And what we have given out of this 20 lakh crore stimulus, almost 9% is in some sense credit guarantees, which means real stimulus would probably not be more than 2 lakh crore. Chidambaram has done some calculation, Professor Ramakumar from TIS has done calculation, various business consultants have done calculations, all of them have almost uniformly come to the figure of 1.8 to 1.2 is the variation. So I have averaged it to say 1%, and I'm probably being more optimistic than pessimistic on that count. Probably the real stimulus is probably even less than 1%. So I'm going to stop on the economy at this point. I want to go to the other part, because I have another 7 minutes that Srujana has allotted me. So in the 7 minutes, I want to talk about certain other aspect of this so-called stimulus. You will see a large part of the stimulus talks about what is called the Atmanirbhar Bharat. Now, you know, this translated to a slogan is about self-reliant economy, self-reliant India. Now, when you talk about a self-reliant India, what is the expectation that we have all have? That means that self-reliance is you are able to do everything yourself. That's the expectation. But not in this particular case, because self-reliant in India has started with first thing they said, you know, in defense, we are going to allow up to 74% foreign investment. Now, if a foreign company owns 74% of a company which produces arms, which produces aircraft, which produces ships, in what way do we self-reliant? Because obviously, the most important part of today's any of these are the core technologies. And the core technologies, as we know, are electronics, software, chips, and so on. So if you have seen, you've been observing the fight between China and the United States, you know it's being fought over chips and software. That's where the real issue is coming up. And if you see that, you will realize this talk of an Atmanirbhar Bharat, where self-reliance means allowing foreign companies to locate in India. So what you're talking about is location. that they should be located in India, and if they put up a factory in India, automatically somewhere India has become self-reliant. You see, ultimately it's a people and their knowledge which makes a difference. It is not where the nuts and bolts are located, because without the knowledge, none of the modern industries today, or modern aircraft, or modern anything can work. So basically the difference between anything which was there 100 years back and what is there today is the fact that the knowledge that goes into it, which is finally, it is frozen into hardware and software. That is what differentiates an artifact, an instrument which was built 100 years back, or a gun which was built 100 years back, to what it is today. Not that it is being produced in India, or is being produced in Germany, produced in Russia. That's not what determines it. So the fact that a foreign company is going to make a foreign companies will make us Atmanirbhar, that itself automatically raises all kinds of questions for me. And that is the opposite of what self-reliance was when India became independent. We did not say, just have factories here which you own. We said you have to transfer knowledge. You have to transfer technology. Within 5 years, you have to transfer every bit of knowledge that you have so our people can produce ourselves. We also set up institutions, science, technology institutions at the time, including CSIR, the public sector undertakings, all of that, including the IITs, all of that allowed a human infrastructure to be built. Unfortunately, that is not the investment we are making today. When you're talking self-reliant, what you're saying is, come and set your, put up your factory here and we'll provide you labor cheap. The second argument that has come during this period is a huge assault on the working class. Unions virtually are going to be disallowed the way it is, because hire and fire is being allowed. The owner can fire anybody whenever he wants. So all the labor laws are going to be put in abeyance, almost all of them. We are also talking about that instead of 8-hour week, which is something which all over the world, the working class has fought more than 150 years for this. Okay, started with the Haymarket. That's what the May Day is really. It was about an 8-hour day, which means 8 hours we work, 8 hours we sleep, 8 hours we have for our leisure. This is how the 8-hour day came into existence. You now have our great philanthropist who set up Infosys, Narayan Murthy, talking about how the workers should now work for 12 hours a day. And I believe that some of the governments run by BJP are considering even a 14-hour day. So what you are talking about is no longer wage slavery. You are actually talking about slavery. But what you are telling foreign capitalists, come set up industries here and we'll give you labor, basically a slave labor. We'll give you land free and you have your own market. Now, the last part which I will deal with, this is I'm coming back to my last 2 minutes sprint to the end, after which Srujana will cut me off. So last 2 minutes, I will start by saying, what is the vision that Modi has? Because obviously there is a vision. So Modi is doing all the things he wanted to do, which is basically break the labor unions, break all the opposition he has had about privatizing public sector. That's also a part of his Atmanirbhar Bharat, and inviting foreign capital. So a completely outright capitalist agenda, which is what the BJP always had, coupled with what I call the accountant's vision, not the economic vision. But with that, there is another part that is also there, which is China and America are fighting. The United States and China are already in some kind of, shall we say, economic war. Trump has declared war on China. Trade war is what it was earlier. Then it became vaccine war. Now there is a threat also of nuclear competition, where the nuclear negotiator, the arms control negotiator, Marshall Billingsley, has said, we know how to win economic wars. We will spend you to oblivion. So we will threaten nuclear competition with you. You will have to spend money and you will become bankrupt. I'm not getting into international finance, how the United States manages to keep a huge deficit when others don't. I'm leaving that those parts out. But at the same time, the American economy is still the biggest in the world. So there is this threat of competition with China. And one of the consequences of that is the belief that all those companies, American companies, which have functioning industrial units in China will have to relocate from China. Therefore, they'll go to Vietnam, they'll go to Bangladesh. And of course, Mr. Modi thinks a lot of them will come to India. And therefore, sell our labor tied hand and foot to foreign capital, give our land to them, allow them to set up companies which they completely control, and this will be India's path to economic growth. And that is the other part of this whole Atmanirbhar Bharat. So Atmanirbhar Bharat essentially means we should now partner with the United States. They're not saying it publicly because they can't, but that will all explain why we are having these small skirmishes in the northern border. Of course, we are also having it with Nepal. So it's not only, this is not the reason. But there is a shift away from India now into believing it has to align with the United States, because that will allow relocation of American industries from China into India. So this is, I think, the other part of the game plan that this government has. So none of it looked very good. And the biggest problem we have is that this stimulus, not being a stimulus, means this year all of us are going to have a very hard time. And if the economy does not grow, that means this year we are likely to see huge numbers of closures and the kind of economic already loss the people are having, this is probably going to continue. A lot of it is needless loss, because we have the ability to print money, have the ability to provide actual cash stimulus. This is what all economists, all from left to center, except extreme right, everybody has been saying this, and the government refuses to do it and have not given any explanation why they are unwilling to take this step. And it only seems to be the fear of global finance that they're not willing to give, extend this kind of stimulus, which even the United States and the UK, the European Union, all of them have been deficit hawks, all of them have been doing. So, Sujana, I overshot my time limit by 2 minutes. So I think that's a good record.
That's totally fine, Praveen. So we have a lot of questions here. I think you'll be ready for all of them. So the first question is, with the migrant crisis and increasing number of migrants heading home, will there be an excessive pressure on agrarian system? Does stimulus package have any solution for this?
Well, at the moment, there is no question that it will make the agrarian situation much worse. Why did these people leave the villages to come to towns? Because there isn't enough employment, there isn't enough money in the agrarian economy. Already, and this is something the other Sujana has already done in, I think, in Andhra and in Haryana, Telangana, they did some surveys. What they found was that the actual rural income, people who live in rural areas, only 50% comes from agriculture, more than 50% comes from other things, which could be economic activity of different kinds, but not directly agriculture. Now, therefore, that is also going to slow down. So there is not enough employment in rural areas for them to be able to continue or they earn an income there. A lot of them are landless laborers, but a lot of them are small farmers. One brother stays in the village, the other brothers go to the city. So their income is actually affects both ways. It affects them directly, but it also goes back to the village. So that is also affected. So I think this migrant labor problem is not a migrant problem. It's a problem also of the rural economy we're likely to see. So I do not see their going back is anything but a strategy for survival. That the trees will get food at home, that's what they think. Here they don't even have food. So I think this is not going to be solved by their going back to the village in terms of what you're of the economy itself. In terms of economic activity, I don't think there is going to be rural employment that they will find.
The second question, we see that the big companies grew and billionaires have gotten richer during this time of pandemic. How can we explain this?
Well, obviously, it impacts the industries differentially. So if you are a small kirana shop, you're not able to open. Okay. Even if you open, how do you get goods come into your shop? How do you bring them in? You're not able to travel. People used to come and give you goods. They're not able to do it very easily. But if you look at, for instance, Swiggy, you look at Amazon, you look at Flipkart, all of them actually can grow at in this period for next 3 to 6 months. While we have lockdowns of different orders, instead of going to the shops, we are more likely to order from these outlets. So what you're seeing is that certain companies will grow, but mostly what you see is growth in the stock market. You're not really seeing growth in physical terms. So that's the problem that we have. And if you have growth in the stock market, all it means is I have money. I have to put it somewhere. Since I can't put it into savings schemes, because the government hasn't many savings schemes. And the RBI bonds are one of the last savings schemes that existed. I think the real rate of return was 4.4%. So after taxes and every other deduction that we had, even that has now been stopped. So what do I do with the money if I have? So I go and put it in the stock market. I don't have any other option. I can't keep it under my bed. So this is the stock market growth is not a real growth of the economy. So the millennials we are talking about, we're only talking of a small section which is there in certain businesses which may not have seen the hit. But otherwise, I don't think the millennials are also going to have an easy time right now. Yes, what they would have is if they are in certain specific sectors which are much more internet-based. Suppose you are doing internet-based education, you might say a sudden big leap take place. Zoom has grown enormously because a lot of the activities which used to take place in meeting halls today takes place to Zoom. So you are going to see these kind of companies increasing, but net, total amount, if you take the pluses and negatives, you're going to see a huge fall in income from all sections, including, to my mind, millennials.
Okay. So the next question, can government frame certain rules and regulations while offering labor and land which benefits Indian economy to higher extent?
Well, of course, there are n number of schemes they could do. So that's something which is very easy to do. But the simplest of that is just offer money. That instead of saying, you know, 1 lakh crore will be given as credit, give 1 lakh crore to the people. Where is the money going to come from? As the economists have said, print the money. You can easily print the money, increase your deficit. So a government, unlike you and me, has the ability to print money. And therefore, money is not a constraint. It's a constraint for the state governments, because state governments cannot build their deficit. And unfortunately, the state governments are also not getting money from the center. In fact, state governments are not able to get even their due share of the GST, which they already are supposed to have been paid, I think, last October or November. Even that money has not been paid to them. So what you have is actually squeeze on the states. Even that is the transfer from the center to states is not taking place. So you're using states' money. You're using the money of the people through savings. You're forcing people to cut their salaries to give to the various PM funds, which are being announced. Not, we don't know who's going to run them. They don't seem to be under any audit and so on. But all of that put aside, you still have obvious ways to help the people. And as I said, the simplest way is to actually help the people by giving them cash. If you give them cash, they'll spend it. If they spend it, economic activity will start. That's the fundamental argument that people are making.
Okay. The next question, what will be left's definitive response for the disguised or pseudo-stimuli?
I really didn't understand the question.
Okay, I'll repeat it again for you. What will be left's definitive responsive for the disguised or pseudo-stimuli?
Well, First is expose the pseudostimuli, but exposing it is not going to be good enough. We have to give alternate plans. So one of the alternate plans is what we said, give money to lands and people. The second alternate plan would be create productive assets. And there are n number of ways you can create productive assets. The third will be to give the small and medium scale industry actual physical money. Again, give them money, not credit, give them money. So transfer money to their accounts. If you want them to pay workers, pay the workers. You can pay the workers directly. Say, here is the money. Get me your workers' names. I'll transfer money to them directly on your account. So there are n number of things the government can and should do, which actually even the US government is doing. You claim you have Aadhaar, you have Jan Dhan accounts. All these things are there. But when it comes to the crunch, you actually have to transfer money into people's accounts. You find none of them are actually working the way they're supposed to. So this is the key issue. The agriculture, the farmers are supposed to get a certain amount of money. So that they were already said that they will get 6,000 per year. Now, if you say that is a stimulus, that's not a stimulus. That was promised earlier. It's already there in your budget. So if you want to give the stimulus, transfer more money to them at the moment. So kick-starting the economy means transferring money to the people's account. But let's not forget one thing. We have to do it at the same time. For instance, you have to control the epidemic. That's also one of your targets. So what prevents us from putting a whole testing scheme in which the swabs are produced here, the PCRA machines are produced here, the reagents are produced here, the whole supply chain that you need, which you will need tomorrow for vaccines as well, but the entire supply chain you invest in, put in money over there, that's economic activity. And that economic activity will also immediately push up employment as well as put money in the hands of the people. So there are a whole set of things you have to do in any case during this particular epidemic. And unfortunately, epidemic is being treated as a law and order issue, where the police enforce curfew, enforce section 144, say after 7 p.m. you cannot go out of the house, and all 65-year-olds and above, including me, we are supposed to be now only stay at home. We can't even go to the park, supposedly. So this kind of so-called policing is not a public health response. Public health response should have been contact tracing, testing, really increasing testing. And testing is an economic activity, which has both ends, keeping the country free of the epidemic, reduce the impact of the epidemic, at the same time provide employment, as well as if you test. Of course, you need a whole lot of economic other stuff that will follow. That means you need to have the testing equipment, the reagents, everything that you need will also mean economic activity. So all of these, you could also tailor to the pandemic. So economic activity would not just be, you know, what used to be done in the olden times, that you wanted to give famine relief, you asked them to do some work. It didn't matter what. As long as they got some money, they could survive. So with this would actually be economic activity, which could be even tailored to essentially the pandemic. So all of these things are possible. But for doing that, you have to accept the first basic premise, which is I need to print money. I need to actually widen the deficit. Without that, you really can't do any of these things. Because this year, your government income is going to drop. So in any case, your revenue side, you will get less. And if you get less money, you will not be able to balance the books. So you have to widen your deficit in any case. So why not kickstart the economy, in which case your loss of revenue will be less, and therefore your deficit may at the end of it not be too bad.
Okay. The next question. Is India ready with human resources with enough skill to serve the requirement of industries to come and set up in India from China?
That's a very good question. You know, the Americans were at one point, and it's not me that was saying it. In fact, it was the chairman, CEO of Apple who had said it. He said, in America, we don't have labor who can do what the Chinese are doing. We can't really manufacture any of our boards in the United States. We just don't have people. So it's not enough to have physical labor. You need people who understands technology at a certain level. And do we have the skill set in the country? That's a good question. and it's not very clear that we have, particularly because if we see, look at our education institutions in the 70s, 80s, 90s, we could claim we had the IITs, which are the cutting edge of technology. We had the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. We had various universities which had really good science departments. So we could claim that we had a basic human infrastructure. But the last 20, 25, 30 years, we have created private universities. We have put the money, we have taken money out of these places. If we look at the IIT, very honestly, the infrastructure of the IITs today is that of a second-rate engineering college in the US or in the European, in Germany or France. So you really have not built any infrastructure from post 90 onwards, very few, in terms of upgrading your technical and scientific manpower, human power. We haven't really done that. So we have a problem that when you go into the number of science publications, number of PhDs, number of papers which have been produced from India, you'll see we are far below China. China is in fact 10 times more than what the United States produces in terms of technical manpower of a certain level. Without that, can we really attract the industries from China to India? I think we have a problem. And that's a bigger problem the US has in its competition with China. It's a problem we also have if we are trying to attract industries which will relocate from China to India.
Okay, the next question. What is the purpose of huge amounts of stored food in government godowns if the government is not ready to distribute them in crisis time? Is the government showing accountability for the storage of food?
Well, sir, it's a question which is, again, for which we don't seem to have any rational answer, because they have allowed some food to come out of that enterprise shops as they've increased the quota of food that people, food grains people can have. But the point is, you have huge amounts of food grains which are there, which effectively are feeding a very healthy rat population. So why they're not releasing this food stocks to the public is a complete, as I said, completely a question for which no answer has ever been given. At one point, if you remember, the government had a proposal that they are going to use something like 2 million metric tons to produce actually ethanol. Now, ethanol is actually ethyl alcohol. It can be used for both making what is called country India, what is it? India made foreign liquor. Okay, whiskey, all these things essentially come from ethanol equivalents, which your liquor industry makes. So the alcohol industry is really the one which seems to would have benefited from this 2 million transfer from the rye of the rice stocks from the FCI godowns to the sugar companies, where a lot of this alcohol molasses are produced. I think that the outcry that took place has actually stopped this. But there is a serious proposal. We have too much food right now, about I think 3 weeks or 4 weeks back, that we should produce 2 million tons of alcohol, call it ethanol, and that's it. You know. So this is a very, when I say, again, the heartlessness of this government is one part of it. The other part of it is the complete, what I will say, the tone-deaf nature of the government. They're not able to hear. And this is one of the problems that we have of this government particularly. I think Mr. Modi listens only to himself. He doesn't listen to anybody else. I don't think there's anybody in the government who can even tell him what he needs to hear. And I don't think he doesn't even hear what is it that, you know, people are saying. Of course, he's got an extremely good public relations campaign going. Every relief that goes into the hands of the people is branded with PM. PM Phalana Yojana, PM Ye Yojana, PM Ka Ye Yojana. So everything apparently is coming from Mr. Modi. He's working very hard night and day to reach people money. Now, because it's all branded Mr. PM, Mr. Modi, giving money. Therefore, people seem to believe he's actually doing something also. So this is the problem. He believes that if you control the media, you control today, particularly during lockdown, then no protests are possible. So you have an ability to control the narrative completely. And it doesn't matter what you do at the moment, you know, as long as you can tell the people what you'd want them to hear, that this is okay, that he will not get exposed. But you can see, therefore, the vision of this government is, well, you know, come elections, people will forget all about that. I'll have a few riots. I'll say it's all being done by Muslims or it's being done by China. I'll have a small war, maybe on the border with China, whip up completely nationalist fervor again, or have something with Pakistan, and I'll win the election. So if you look at it from that point of view, it's a belief, I think he does believe this, that you can be, you know, fool the people, all the people, all the time. This is the belief that in the age of social media, in the age where you control the media, that you can actually create, quote unquote, your reality, and the real world will not matter. This is the belief. I believe that that is completely wrong. And yes, you can fool the people for some time, but not forever. And reality will break such illusions that he may have. The task that we have is, how do you work under conditions of pandemic where you cannot do your normal instruments, which is mobilize on the ground, talk to people and do all of that. So I think this is the crisis that we have. And this is where I'm looking forward to young people who are here in this audience to create the instruments for our mass outreach. And how do we protest in times of COVID? That is a challenge I'm going to leave to all of you. You have to unmute yourself, Sujana.
Yeah, thanks for that. The last question, is government going to pay the 50% cut off salaries since last 2 months to government employees from this package?
Well, they have to pay the 50% they have cut. At the moment, will they pay it from this package? I'm not sure, honestly. I really don't know the answer to that. Okay. I suspect government really can't do that, but we'll have to see.
We have come to the end of the today's session. I thank Prabir for taking time out of his schedule and sharing his valued opinion with us this evening. I would also like to thank all our viewers for joining us. Please follow our social media handles for upcoming talks. Once again, thank you all and good evening.